Finally tonight, the unfolding mystery of a huge and exciting new archaeological find. It's all happening on a group of islands off the northern tip of Scotland. Jeffrey Brown reports.
Drive across the windswept, almost treeless landscape of the Orkney Islands, and you'll see sheep, cattle, and farmland. But it won't be long before you come across an ancient standing stone, or two, or three. The islands are littered with a collection of world-famous archaeological sites. There's Skara Brae, a superbly preserved Neolithic hut settlement. Mayshow, a chambered stone tomb, built so the midwinter sun shines along its low entrance hall. And the standing stones of Stenness. But now, nearby, a site recently unearthed to top them all, the Ness of Brodgar. A vast temple-like complex, one of the most important Neolithic discoveries in Europe that may provide new insight into Stone Age religious practice.
The Ness of Brodgar is kind of an archaeologist's dream site. What we have is a complex of structures, the like of which we've never really seen before in Atlantic Europe. Buildings of scale and complexity in architecture, enclosed within this massive walled enclosure. It's just spectacular.
Nick Card heads up excavation at the site for the Orkney Research Center for Archaeology. He was in Washington recently to lecture on the work. We spoke in the gallery of the Society of Women Geographers, surrounded by photos from the islands.
It was a focus for activity for over 1,000 years. And I think through that 1,000 years, its purpose, its meaning, its function would have changed. But I think it did have a religious function, as you say, perhaps reaching out to the gods, to the deities that these people believed in.
The site dates to around 3300 BC, well before the construction of Stonehenge, some 700 miles to the south. It was the Neolithic or Late Stone Age, a time of transition from hunting and gathering to farming and settled communities. In more modern times, as this painting from 1855 shows, the site was essentially hiding in plain sight under a huge mound of earth.
This mound, I live just up the road from it. I've driven past it hundreds of times. And yes, you always thought, this has got to be natural. It's too big to be artificial.
So you were driving past it all these years and you thought, maybe something's going on, but you had no idea.
Exactly. And then just over 10 years ago, this has all changed. And what it has been revealed is this totally unique site.
How did you feel the first time you realized that? Were you excited or do you feel like a bit of an idiot for driving past it for many years?
Well, I think if I felt a bit of an idiot, I'm sure that all the other archaeologists in Britain probably felt the same, because it is one of those archaeological meccas that everybody comes to see at least once in a lifetime.
In fact, the site was stumbled upon accidentally by a local couple who wanted to plant a garden. When they hit upon a notched stone slab, archaeologists were called in. Since that first discovery in 2003, the dig has steadily expanded, revealing a walled complex of large ceremonial structures. More than 20 have been uncovered so far, and geophysical tests show they're only the tip of the iceberg.
When you see photographs of a site, it looks huge.
Yeah.
But that trench, our biggest trench, only covers 10% of the site. The site itself covers the equivalent of 5 soccer pitches.
The Ness, which means headland or promontory, stretches along 2 bodies of water and is sandwiched between what's left of 2 ancient standing stone circles. Card says the location is no accident.
I think that the whole landscape, when you stand in the middle of the Ring of Brodgar, you get the sense of being in the middle of this huge natural amphitheatre created by the hills all the way around and then the water on either side. It's a unique landscape, very special landscape, and no doubt had a very special significance to our Neolithic ancestors.
Card points to clues that this was a special ceremonial site, a beautifully polished stone axe, stone mace heads carefully placed, grooved pottery, and even painted walls.
It wasn't kind of floor-to-ceiling, you know, magnolia. Mm-hmm. It was, you know, specific colours in specific places. Mm-hmm. And again, we're finding this, the first evidence in Britain, for that some of the pottery was painted. So suddenly this monochrome world that's so often the archaeological record presents to us is transformed into this kind of psychedelia.
But mysteries abound as to the exact nature of the place, including why, after those 1,000 years of activity, it all came to an end. Archaeologists were stunned to find that the site had been filled in, and that underneath lay the bones of hundreds of cattle, possibly the remains of a huge feast.
Cattle, yeah. Hundreds of them. It's one of the biggest barbecues in history.
Why one last, whatever you want to call it, barbecue, and then closing the place?
Roughly when this was happening, you get the introduction of the first metalwork, bronze. And with bronze, the introduction of bronze, you get changes in burial practice, changes in society. There seems to be much more emphasis on the individual rather than the wider community, the kind of social structures that made the nest possible and kept it there at the kind of pinnacle of Neolithic society was suddenly eclipsed.
Card hopes to find more answers and more objects when the digging resumes this summer at the giant Nests of Brodgar complex.